Hello? Good morning, everyone. Happy Sabbath. It is wonderful to see all of you here and also who are watching online. It's always, always joyous to be in the house of the Lord and also watching online, forgetting our worries and everything else aside. So let's stand at this time for our opening song. Opening song is number 499, What a Friend We Have in Jesus. Opening song is 499, What a Friend We Have in Jesus. We have in Jesus all our sins and griefs to bear. What a privilege to carry everything to God in prayer. Oh, what peace we often remain standing for prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you and praise you for bringing us here, Lord. We also thank and praise you for the people who have joined online, Father. Father, help us to have this precious trust and faith in you, Lord, that you will guide us and direct us in this life and that you will forgive our sins and save us in your kingdom when you come again. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Please be seated. We are learning about faith, faith of Abraham. Exercising faith improves our spiritual life, no doubt. Physical exercise improves our physical life. I'm going to share some of the things that exercise helps to maintain good physical life. Exercise helps us control our weight. We maintain at our optimum weight so that we don't get chronic illnesses. It also combats health conditions and diseases. It helps to raise the high density lipoprotein level, which is called the HDL level or the good cholesterol. We don't want the bad cholesterol, that is the LDL cholesterol. So exercise helps increase your HDL cholesterol, the good cholesterol, and also decreases the triglycerides, which is the bad thing as well. It also helps prevent and manage many health problems, including stroke, metabolic syndrome, high blood pressure, diabetes, depression, anxiety, many types of cancers, arthritis, falls, and it also improves cognitive function. Physical activity improves your mood. It stimulates various brain chemicals such as endorphins. It makes you feel happy and euphoric without the drugs. I like that, don't you? It boosts energy. It also promotes better sleep. It helps you fall asleep faster, get better sleep, and deepens your sleep. But just be careful that you don't sleep just before going to bed because it energizes you and disrupts your sleep. Set a routine time for it so that you will get used to that routine. It also helps us to develop healthy sexual life. I'm sure we all need that too. Exercise can be fun and it is social. Get at least 150 minutes of moderate aerobic activity or 75 minutes of vigorous activity a week, or a combination of both moderate or vigorous and vigorous activity. But remember to check with your doctor if you have not exercised in a while, if you have chronic health condition, so that he will give you an okay for you to start your exercise program. May God bless you. At this time, we will have our mission spotlight.
For nearly 6 years, Dr. Manuel Belisillo served as a medical missionary at Buya Seventh-day Adventist Hospital in the African country of Cameroon. Dr. Belisillo and his wife, Elma, were just months from completing their term of service. Those 6 years at Buya were only part of a 25-year mission service career for Dr. Belisillo.
Every time we ask help, he is ready to help this patient, to help this hospital. He was always a dedicated doctor.
Dr. Belisillo began his medical career in Calbayog City and later in Palawan in the Philippines. Soon after being confirmed as a certified family physician, he and his family accepted a call to Africa. They served for 11 years at Yuka Adventist Hospital in a remote area some 550 miles or 990 kilometers east of Lusaka, the country's capital. For a time, he was the only doctor at the hospital and therefore on call around the clock. The call to mission service was a way of life for Manuel and Elma. From Zambia, they moved to Kanye Seventh-day Adventist Hospital in Botswana. Then, for the next 5 years, they served at Shire Memorial Hospital in Nepal. From Nepal, they journeyed back to Africa to serve at Baturi Adventist Hospital in Cameroon before moving to Buya Seventh-day Adventist Hospital in 2014. Regardless of where he served, Dr. Belisillo would encourage his patients to read the Bible so they could be prepared for Jesus' soon coming. In addition, he served as a church elder and a Sabbath school teacher, as well as organizing outreach programs in various countries. In early May 2020, Dr. Belisillo contracted malaria, and tests later showed he had also contracted COVID-19. On June 17, 2020, Dr. Manuel Belisillo fell asleep in Jesus. He was the first active international missionary for the Seventh-day Adventist Church to succumb to the pandemic sweeping the world. Like many Adventist missionaries, Dr. Belisillo was serving far from his homeland and family because he had answered Jesus' call by saying, "I will go." Dr. Belisillo leaves two daughters, both physicians at Palawan Adventist Hospital, and a son, a laboratory scientist. As we know all too well, COVID-19 has killed millions, and we have also lost many Adventist believers and church workers, our colleagues in mission to the pandemic. Like Dr. Belisillo, These dedicated workers fell in the line of duty, carrying a message of hope to a dying world, a message of hope in His soon return. Let us remember that God leaves us on earth to encounter storms and conflicts, to perfect Christian character, to become better acquainted with God our Father and Christ our elder brother, and to do work for the Master in winning many souls to Christ, that with glad heart we may hear the words, "Well done, good and faithful servant. Enter thou in to the joy of thy Lord." Until we meet again on that glorious day.
Good morning again. It is time for us to begin our lesson study. I'm sure all of you studied your lesson and going to actively participate, right? So today is lesson number 7. The title is The Covenant with Abraham. God loves us so much that He doesn't do anything without telling us. And He makes a covenant with us, explaining what He wants us to do and what He will do in return for us, right? The greatest victories gained for the cause of God are not the result of labored argument, ample facilities, wide influence, or abundance of means. They are gained in the audience chamber with God when, with earnest, agonizing faith, men lay hold upon the mighty arm of power. Our lives, ourselves, are already His. Faith acknowledges His ownership and accepts its blessings. It's taken from Gospel Workers, page 259. Our memory text says this from Genesis 15:2. But Abraham said, "Lord God, what will you give me, seeing I go childless, and the heir of my house is Eleazar of Damascus?" So this puts us in a position that we can question God, right? We can ask Him when we are going through trials, "What good is it that I'm going to church all these years and my flock are not going to be with me?" Do we have the right to question God? Yes, we do. And that's Abraham is asking, "What's the point if I don't have a child? What's the point?" So the Abrahamic covenant is a second covenant after the covenant of Noah. Abraham's covenant involves other nations as well, for ultimately the covenant with Abraham is part of the everlasting covenant which is offered to all of us. This lesson points us about things that Abraham is facing, his fear, right? He is afraid if he doesn't have a child, what will happen to him? He is afraid how he is going to fare in that new place with that God had led him. And Sarah and Hagar's fears too. Sarah is afraid that she won't be having a child like God promised. She's afraid, she's doubting. Abraham laughs, Sarah laughs, and Ishmael too. Abraham's passion about tending to the strangers, his hospitality towards these foreign people. And it also talks about how Abraham's name is changed from exalted father to father of all nations. Also talks about Sarah's name being my princess, Sarai, changed to Sarah, who is the princess of all nations. So, Abraham had been traveling through Canaan for some time when God decided to confirm His covenant with him through a series of visions. Sometimes I think to myself, Abraham was led by God to a foreign country, foreign place. He left all his kindred and everything that he had and went where God told him to go. I think to myself, I'm also in that position. God told me to leave my home country, leave my parents, leave my kindred, and come to this foreign country to show me the truth. I was raised as a Hindu worshipping idols, and He pulled me out of that place and brought me here and showed me the truth. I identify sometimes with Abraham like that. Abraham believed it, but Sarah got impatient. Eventually, God himself appeared to clarify the promise. This lesson brings us that although Abraham was faithful to God, although Abraham trusted in him for the promise to come through, there were moments in his life that he doubted. There were moments in his life that he listened to Sarah, thinking that he's helping God. God doesn't need our help. If he says something he will do it in his own due time. Sometimes we are impatient. We want things to be done at our own timing. We just have to be patient, and it is very difficult. That's very, very difficult. But with God's help, we will overcome all of those things. Abraham didn't think about himself as he was talking with the Lord of the universe face to face. He interceded for the few righteous people in Sodom instead. Abraham did not only think about himself, he was not selfish. Although Abraham and Lot had conflict because their flocks did not have enough pasture, and so they decided to go their own ways, right? Still, Abraham did not harbor any revenge or anything in his heart. He gave Lot the first preference. He said to his nephew, "You pick whichever side you want to go, then I will go the opposite side." And yet, when problem came for Lot, he was there fighting, right, for his sake. Last week you probably read also he fought them from the Elamites, right? And this time, yes, he's arguing with God to spare that city that he is living in. Sunday talks about the faith of Abraham. Monday talks about Abraham's doubts. Tuesday talks about the sign of the Abrahamic covenant. Wednesday is the son of promise. Thursday talks about Lot and what happened in Sodom. The faith of Abraham. God's first response to Abraham's concern about an heir is that he will have a son from his own body. Abraham was reassured and believed in the Lord because he understood that fulfillment of God's promise depended not on his own righteousness but on God's. Yet, after a time, he failed, if you remember. In the religion of the ancient Egyptians, for instance, judgment was made on the basis of counting one's human works of righteousness against the righteousness of goddess Mat, who represented divine righteousness. In short, they thought that they can earn their salvation by their own works. And that's not how God works. You can do as many good things as you want, and that is not going to help you go to heaven. What is going to help you to go to heaven is trusting in him, having faith in him, understanding that our sins are covered by his righteousness, and that's what is going to take us to heaven. Because we have that knowledge that God has forgiven our sins and he's going to take us to heaven, because he is loving us so much, we love him in return and we live a good life, godly life. Abraham shared his doubts about the promised seed when he met with God again. God assured him that his son would be his heir. Abraham believed him. Then the covenant was confirmed. And what did Abraham do? What did God ask Abraham to do? If you read, you would know that they had this sacrificial ceremony that he performed. He took a 3-year-old heifer, a 3-year-old female goat, a 3-year-old ram, a turtle dove, and a young pigeon. And he cut them in half, right? Cut them in pieces and separated them. And he was watching over them so that the vultures would not come and take these carcasses, eat them, right? So the animals were sacrificed, and that is symbolic of Christ dying for our sins. Vultures were flying around. And what that meant was Israel would be enslaved temporarily, which is 400 years, temporarily. God's timing is not our timing, right? 400 years, 4 generations. And then they came out, right? The burning torch, that represented God committed to fulfill his promises. God is a God who operates on his own timing, who operates, who says what he will do, and he will do. So we can be rest assured that If God said something, he will carry it out. The boundaries of this promised land, from the river of Egypt to the great river, the river Euphrates, remind us of the boundaries of the Garden of Eden. In Abraham's descendants taking the country of Canaan looms the idea of the end time salvation of God's people, which is returning to the Garden of Eden, which is ultimately the paradise for us. The boundaries of the promised land are set. Going back to Eden. Are you excited to go back to Eden? I am. Where there will be no sickness, no suffering, no death, no sorrow, only joy and happiness, and being with the Lord and seeing him every day, talking to him face to face. And that is the ultimate thing I want, and I'm sure you all want too. Monday's lesson talks about Abraham's doubts. I had mentioned before that it's okay. Sometimes we are human beings, we doubt. And these lessons are put forth for us to understand that all these giants, all these patriarchs, all these people who are so strong in their faith also failed at times. So that gives us the hope that even if we fail sometimes, we will be restored back to him. Just like how God was restoring Abraham back to him, coming back into his life, establishing the covenant. When Abraham doubted, God unambiguously reassured him that he would have a son. Years later, Abraham is still without a son. Even after God's last powerful prophecy, Abraham seems to have lost his faith. He doesn't believe anymore that it will be possible for him to have a son with Sarai. Sarai, if you recall Eve, they are very hasteful, impulsive, right? They want to do things quicker. Eve said, I'm going to eat this fruit so that I will know what is good and evil. And it's going to make me like God. Sarai did the similar thing. She was hasteful, impulsive. God said he'll give a son. Okay, let me have a son through Hagar, the surrogate mother. Sarai, feeling hopeless, takes the initiative and urges him to resort to a common practice of that time in the ancient Near East, that is taking a surrogate. Hagar, Sarai's servant, is appointed for this service. Just like Adam, very passive. Instead of resisting and telling Eve not to do what she did and him not partaking in it, Abraham did the same thing, similar thing. He listened to Sarai and he said, maybe my wife is right. Maybe I should do what she's saying. Whoever tells you anything, if it is not according to God's word, you don't have to listen. Again, be it your husband, be it your wife, be it your son or daughter, if it is not according to God's word, we don't have to listen. It'll bring heartaches, 100%, but you are standing for what you believe in. So the story goes, Abraham listened and married Hagar and thought to himself that the son that God promised would be that son. That's not the case, right? After waiting for 10 years, Sarai lost all hope of being the mother of the seed. She proposed an alternative, a surrogate mother. Looks like reason won over faith. Sometimes we reason. How is that possible? All the things that are put in front of us seems like things are going this way. And if God says things are going to go the other way, how is that going to be possible? Yes, it is going to be possible because it's God who is telling us this, not human beings. Sarai doubted and acted against God's will as Eve did. Abraham compromised and followed her as Adam did. The consequences of that mistake are still affecting to this day, is it not? However, God always shows his love even when we make bad decisions. He promised protection to Hagar and Ishmael. Even though Hagar married Abraham when God didn't say so and had a child, still, he protected Hagar and Ishmael. He made them a great nation too. The Holy Book contains nothing that is non-essential. Nothing is revealed that has not a bearing upon our actual lives. This holy book is guiding our lives. And let us read every day and know God's will for our lives. Tuesday's lesson, the sign of Abrahamic covenant. Yes, Pastor.
Yeah, we have a comment online here. It says, there are times things seem to be impossible. With God, all things are possible.
Yes, definitely. Because our God is all-powerful, and God knows everything. We do not know everything. Yes, Diane.
I think I took this note from the E.G. White writings for the lesson. But this is a paraphrase. When faith is lacking, it's because we can grasp only the things seen. But when we are exercising true faith is when we take hold of the yet unseen as if it were already seen and known.
Yes, definitely. Abraham's lack of faith, as seen in the preceding story, broke the flow of Abraham's spiritual journey with God. God reconnects with Abraham and brings him back to the point when he had made a covenant with Abraham. So that is what will happen with us too. Sometimes if we break off our journey with God, he may be silent for a little bit, wondering if you will come back to him on your own. But if you don't, he will intervene. He will bring things in your life so that you realize what's going on and come back to God. And that's what God is doing for Abraham too. And you shall be circumcised in the flesh of your foreskins, and it shall be a sign of the covenant between me and you. God remained silent for more than 10 years. Then he explained the conditions of the covenant. He began by establishing a sign. Because the rite of circumcision involves the shedding of blood, it could be understood in the context of sacrifice, signifying that righteousness was imputed to him. The promise of the everlasting covenant refers to the work of the messianic seed, the sacrifice of Christ that ensures eternal life to all who claim it by faith, and all that faith entails. So we learned about the name change, didn't we not? So God had instructed us very clearly that we are not to contract marriages with the heathen, for by so doing, we would lose their reverence for God and for his holy law. We would be tempted, to engage in sinful practices of other nations and would be seduced into idolatry. God has given us clear instructions, yet sometimes we fail. It is God that can circumcise our heart. We do not need that physical rite anymore. The circumcision that God had appointed at that time, it means that you are circumcising your heart for God. God circumcises our heart. Moses, Jeremiah, and Paul understood this sign as something more than a physical act. Because if you recall, at the councils of Jerusalem, right, they had mentioned things that needed for the Gentiles to come to God, and circumcision was not one of that. What circumcision is requiring us is a circumcision of our heart. That is what is required. They understood that, and that's why they said it. Yes, Pastor.
Just to add to that, you know, at the time with God, with Abraham, the circumcision was of the heart, but it was also more than that, because it was a sign that you were covenanting with God. You know, it's interesting that he chose a reproductive organ to do the circumcision, because it was making a covenant that whoever you had as a child, you were dedicating them to the Lord. And it was a covenant that I would not have children unless I was willing to have that child for the Lord. So it was broad in the sense that the covenant was that my seed is for Jesus, because the pagans, they were having children for whatever pagan god, for whatever. But with God, in Abraham, God says, for you and your seed. And the way that I'm going to make that clear is that I'm taking a reproductive organ, and you're going to make a sacrifice of that organ, saying that you're covenanting with me. So if you did the circumcision, it means you're saying, yes, I'm making a covenant with the Lord, and my children, if we do it baby dedications, which is nice, and of course, circumcision is not the same emphasis today as it was at the time, but the symbolism was there that whatever child you had, you were making a covenant with God that you were going to raise the child for the Lord, and so that your seed would continue to worship the Lord. And that's why when Abraham did it and he asked the people around to do it, it was to say, you know what? We, with all of our children, are making a covenant with God that we will raise them in the fear of the Lord, which I think is significant that we should today have the same thing. If we're going to have children, okay, but we should understand the significance of having children. We don't want to just have kids to be having kids. Yep. We want to have them for the blessing that comes with them, the relationship, but that we will make a covenant with God that we will do all in our power to raise them in the fear of the Lord.
Yes, definitely. We do all in our power. And after that, since God has given us free will, everyone chooses their way. And we have done our part as parents, right? The covenant goes beyond the physical descendants of Abraham, and it's about the work of the seed, the Messiah. The sacrifice of Jesus brings eternal life to all those who accept it by faith. Names were changed to reflect this promise. Abraham, exalted father, is changed to Abraham, the father of many nations. Sarai, my princess, which means, is changed to Sarah, the princess for everyone. So Wednesday, the son of promise. Who was the son of promise? Isaac. Yes. So Abraham thought that Ishmael could be the son of promise because he is his son, right? But God clearly told him that the son would come from Sarah. He didn't trust that. Many times he's falling. It is not clear whether Abraham knew who these strangers were, even though he acted toward them as if God himself were among them. He was sitting in the tent door in the heat of the day, and because visitors were rare in the desert, he was probably longing to meet with them. Does this happen to any of you guys, that you want somebody to visit your home? It's not a laughing thing, folks. I'm telling you, the rate of suicide is going up and up. Why do you think? Part of it is social life. They do not have friends. They do not have people to share their joys and sorrows. In their hearts, they're longing for somebody to come visit them, share a meal with them, talk to them. Yes? This day and age, social media is there. So many names for it. They seem to have so many followers. They seem to be posting their pictures. They seem to be sharing things with them. Yet, depression and suicide is on the rise. This disease doesn't affect only people who don't have money, low socioeconomic background. This disease does not affect only the uneducated. This disease affects everybody. People who are wealthy, who are educated, who are well-placed in life, careers. So, when Abraham is watching at the tent of his door, see if anyone is coming. If anybody would come to his home, longing for people to visit. As soon as he sees these men, he runs to them, right? Although he was 99 years old, he called one of these persons Adonai, my Lord, a title often used for God. Is anything too hard for the Lord? At the appointed time, I will return to you according to the time of life, and Sarah shall have a son. Abraham was perplexed. Sarah was 90 years old. How could she bear a child? She's past menopausal age. She's way past her menopausal age. It's not possible for her to have a child, physiologically, if you think. But God said he's going to give a child, right? Abraham laughs. God decided to speak with this, about this with them. He came before Abraham in human form along with two angels. And what does Sarah do? Sarah is very inquisitive, listening behind the scenes. Abraham's behavior towards these heavenly strangers will become an inspiring model of hospitality. You know, when we were growing up, nobody need to call us or tell us or announce that they are going to come to your home, right? They just show up at the door, right? And you share a meal, whatever is there. Here, in this day and age, even to your own family members, you have to text and ask, are you free for a call? Is it okay to call you? Right? Yes, Pastor.
Yeah, that's happened in my lifetime, because when I was a kid, it was open. A lot of people think, well, that's just how Americans are. Well, that's how Americans are now, but it's not the way it's always been. It used to be that you would be ready for someone to come over. You'd have special drinks, special snacks in case someone showed up. And then if someone knocked on the door, the whole family would stop whatever they're doing and come mm-hmm. and greet the guest. And then the guest would come in and you would sit and talk with the guest. You would stop whatever you're doing, and as long as the guest wanted to stay there, they could stay there. But it's interesting they did some research, and they found that when television came in, it changed.
Mm-hmm.
And now if someone knocks on the door, you turn out the lights, you hide, you tell the kids to be quiet, you peek out the window.
Yes.
Because you're afraid of who might be at that door.
Yeah.
And the other thing is our homes aren't ready for guests.
Yes.
And so we need to make sure as Christians, as Seventh-day Adventists, our homes are ready for guests, because we're like, oh, we have to clean the house, we're not this, we're afraid of what they might hear, what they might see. And so we have to have our home like Abraham. Abraham's home was ready for guests, and he was watching. And so we have to do the same thing. Not just our homes are symbolic of our lives.
Yes.
Our lives need to be ready for God to bring people, because that then relays and flows over into the church.
Mm-hmm.
When our life is closed, our home is closed, guess what? Our church is closed. We're not open for people to come in. And
yeah.
When people do walk in, we look at them the same way we do at someone at our house. Who are you? What are you doing here? We don't greet them. We don't go talk to them. We don't say anything to them. We hope that they quietly maybe just go away so we can get back to our life and our own little world. And so you're right. There's a lot of lessons here with Abraham having his home ready, and it needs to be for us today. In spite of what society around us is doing, we need to make sure our lives are ready, our homes are ready, so that our church is ready for when God brings someone. Because like it says, you never know. It might be entertaining a stranger, you're entertaining an angel.
Yes, 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 definitely. And they were much more happier and healthier those days. Now you're thinking only about yourself, your busy life. You're more miserable and unhappy. Yes.
We need the mic.
As you know, we are living in a very dangerous world. So based upon what the pastor just mentioned, can you invite homeless to be part of your family?
So that's a very good thought. The sin has penetrated our lives so much. We are like living in fear. You know, we think if you ask somebody whom you do not know, a stranger, to come into your house, what is going to happen to you? What are the consequences of it? And that is the fear that we all live in. But Yes, Pastor.
Yeah, and we have to be careful with that too. You have to understand the time in which we're living in, and be careful of our children, of our family. And so, you know, it's noble, but we don't want to put guilt on people for not doing it, because we realize not everyone is in a stable condition or in a condition that wants to be helped and recover.
Yes.
You know, it's different bringing someone in who wants help and who wants to recover and who wants to change their life and needs the, and yeah. that, and you have to prepare your home for that.
Yeah.
Because if you're not, you know, what things are in the home that may be a deterrent for them getting recovery, and you don't want to just bring someone in that doesn't want help, that doesn't want to recover, because they could harm your family. And so we have to be, like Jesus said, wise as serpents, harmless as doves.
Exactly.
And we do want to do ministry, but we have to do it very wisely, and also realize in 2022 there are evil people out there, and we want to be very careful just inviting them into our home. So I agree with Brother Dominic. We want to have a home that's open and ready for the ones that God brings who wants recovery, because Abraham met those who wanted to be and to have a ministry, not evil. Abraham wouldn't have brought some pagan king that was going to kill his family.
Yeah, yeah.
So there's a balance.
Yes. Yes, Caesar.
Echoing what Dominic said in the past about not inviting everybody, but one of the things that the Bible said, love thy neighbor. However, how do you love thy neighbor when you invite your neighbor? How do you love thy neighbor, but you don't even invite him into your home?
How do you love the neighbor and not invite him to the home? Okay. So the question is, how do you love your neighbor and not invite your neighbor? It is based on the relationship that you have with your neighbor, right? If you have a long-standing relationship with your neighbor, you trust the neighbor, you're inviting the neighbor. If you do not speak with your neighbor, you do not have a relationship with the neighbor, how comfortable would you be inviting that neighbor, right? So first is having a relationship. So the divine intrusion into the human sphere denotes his grace and love toward humanity. This appearance of God anticipates Christ, who left his heavenly home and became a human servant to reach humankind. God's appearance here provides evidence for the certainty of his promise. He sees Sarah, who hides herself behind him and knows her most intimate thoughts. He knows that she laughed, and the word laugh is his last word. Her skepticism becomes the place where he will fulfill his word. Watch out, if God says something, do not laugh, because man plans, God laughs. You think you're planning something, you're doing something, but if that doesn't go with God's plan, it's going to be futile. But if God plans, if you don't go along with it, still it'll come to fruition. Yes, Pastor, you had a question.
Yeah, I don't think Sarah at that moment understood who was in her home. I don't think she grasped, and I think that after she laughed and Jesus confronted her about it, that's when she realized, you know, because remember he said, why'd you laugh? And she said, oh, I didn't laugh. He goes, oh, but you did laugh. I know you laugh. I heard you laugh. I saw you laugh. And then all of a sudden she realized, oh, this is not just some person walking along the road. This is in the presence of the God that Abraham has been following all this time. And that's when I believe she was humbled in the sense. So again, it's being mindful of the people around you who God might bring to you.
Mm-hmm.
You bring and entertain angels.
Yes. So this lesson also points out this, taken from that I May Know Him, page 335. Prayers, exhortation, and talk are cheap fruits which are frequently tied on, but fruits that are manifested in good works, in caring for the needy, the fatherless, and widows are genuine fruits and grow naturally upon a good tree. So, yes, Pastor.
Comment online here, Sister Nova said, in 2022, we have to have the spirit of discernment. Not every neighbor should be invited. Yeah.
Yes. Abraham refers to Ishmael. Abraham's skeptical recommendation requires God to become specific. God's promise does not concern Ishmael. In an echo of Abraham's questions, God responds explicitly with the name of Isaac, Ironically, Isaac means he laughs, resonating with Abraham's laughter, and Sarah had laughed within herself, her most intimate thoughts are known by the visitor. So God decided to speak about this with them, and he came before Abraham in human form along with the two angels. We read what he did, right? He went, prepared a meal, a morsel of bread, he says, but it was an elaborate meal. Abraham was hospitable, so he was eager to take care of the travelers. God himself talked about the promise, and Sarah heard him. Sarah also laughed. God's promise was sure, and Sarah believed. Eventually, God also laughed with the son of faith. Isaac means he will laugh. Thursday's lesson talks about Lot in Sodom. God's promise of a son to Abraham had just been reconfirmed, yet instead of enjoying the good news, he engages God in a passionate discussion about the fate of Lot in Sodom. Abraham not only is a prophet to whom God reveals his will, but he also is a prophet who intercedes on behalf of the wicked. So Abraham, that's why he's in the book of faith, right? Abraham not only thinks about himself, he thinks about others. Abraham challenges God and bargains with him to save Sodom. So this brings us to the point that you can talk to God, you can ask questions with God. Nothing wrong with that. He says, he's challenging God, right? What if you find 50 people in that city? Would you destroy that city? God says, no, I won't destroy the city if I find 50 people. Then he says, 45. Then he goes down the line until he comes to 10. He says, if you find 10 people, would you destroy? So he stops at 10. There's something significant that I learned from this lesson is that 10, when Abraham reaches the number 10, he understands that he has now come to the limit and therefore decides that he will not go beyond this number. After 6 responses, God abruptly ends his conversation with Abraham. Although God consented to consult with humans, he remains sovereign. Because his judgment is the ultimate judgment, right? Abraham manifests this confidence of a child pleading with a loud father. How many times your children come pleading to you, asking for things? You might say no, 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 no in the beginning, and then you give up. You give it to them, right? Sometimes. Not always, right? You know if it is in the best interest of the child, you would give it. If it is not, you will not, right? And that's exactly what happened. Although Abraham wanted Sodom to be saved fully, he could not. And God could not save completely. He only saved, how many people did he save? 4 people, right? And out of the 4, one did not survive because Lot's wife turned back and looked and felt so bad that she's leaving all these riches and going away. She did not trust in God. So she turned back and looked and became a pillar of salt. So only 3 survived. Yes, Pastor?
Yeah, it's interesting. Many believe that the number 10, the reason he stopped was that was the number of the family that was there. So Lot, his wife, Lot's children and their husbands.
Son-in-laws,
And so you see that Lot, Abraham stopped when he said, basically what I said, would you please save my family? So he's like, look, I want all of Sodom saved. That's not going to work. 50, and he realized it's a wicked city. And ultimately, he's just like, Lord, please save my family. And
right.
And that's a powerful prayer, you know, that we have today is, Lord, please save our family. And you see God's mercy that he was saying, yes, I will do it for your family. And he did for those that would leave, which was 4. And ultimately, as you said, one did not. But Abraham was like, please, Lord, will you just save my family? And that's a powerful lesson for us of how we need to pray and intercede for others, yes, but especially our family. And God does hear.
Yes, definitely. Far be it from you to do such a thing as this, to slay the righteous with the wicked, so that the righteous should be as the wicked. Far be it from you, shall not the judge of all the earth do right? That's Abraham questioning God. The angels left for Sodom. God stayed speaking with Abraham. Abraham interceded for Sodom. He negotiated the minimum number of righteous people in Sodom for God to forgive the city. 50, 45, 40, 30, 20, 10. Then the bargaining stopped. 10 is a symbol of minimum. For example, a synagogue could only be opened if at least 10 men were present. Only 4 people were saved and only 3 survived. Not even 5 righteous people were found. Only Lot, his wife, and their 2 daughters. The destruction of Sodom is a symbol of the eventual destruction of the wicked. God, in his mercy, destroys the wicked. In the form of men, angels are often in the assemblies of the righteous, and they visit the assemblies of the wicked as they went to Sodom to make a record of their deeds to determine whether they have passed the boundary of God's forbearance. The Lord delights in mercy, and for the sake of a few who really serve him, he restrains calamities and prolongs the tranquility of multitudes. Abraham's patient and tenacious plea with God on behalf of the people of Sodom should encourage us to pray for the wicked, even though they appear to be in hopeless condition of sin. Every day, the probation of some is closing. Every hour, some are passing beyond the reach of mercy. The spirit of Abraham was the spirit of Christ. The Son of God is himself the great intercessor in the sinner's behalf. Faith is trusting in God, believing that he loves us and knows what is for our best good. Thus, instead of our own way, it leads us to choose his way. In place of our ignorance, it accepts his wisdom. In place of our weakness, his strength. In place of our sinfulness, his righteousness. Our lives, ourselves, are already his. Faith acknowledges his ownership and accepts its blessings. Yes, Pastor.
A couple of comments here online. One, going back to the neighbors, it says we should pray for our neighbors. And so that's true. We need to pray for them. And then another one here, it says, Abraham is another picture of our Lord Jesus interceding for the lost. So Abraham was an example of someone who was interceding, like Daniel interceded as he knew the prophecy was coming to a close. And Daniel 9 is one of the great prayers of intercession, just like in John 17, where Jesus is interceding, that great prayer of intercession. And here you have Abraham interceding in behalf like Jesus does for us.
Yes, as God's children, we should be interceding also. That's also tough if you're not closer with God. Yes, Caesar?
Yes, I mean, this is a good example because Lot's wife was saved. But at the last minute, she turned that salvation into disobedience because she looked back after she was told not to look back, and she turned into a pillar of salt. So here's an example how God, through his grace, gave her salvation, saved her, but then free will again, she decides, no, I want to look back to see what I'm missing.
Yes. Yes. Another comment here?
All of these lessons that we are studying today is for us to apply to our daily life. So as you were talking about Abraham interceding for his nephew Lot, it reminds me of the past lessons where it says that when he asked his nephew to choose, he chose the best land. When he went to fight to rescue him, he decided to stay with close to Sodom and Gomorrah. So even though Lot never, you know, we don't know the inside story, the details, but overall we see that Abraham never stopped seeking his salvation. Even though when the angels came, he still thought about him and interceded for him. So now, let's put it now into 2022. How many times we know people that we know they are in a wrong path? And we get very emotional. Oh, I'm in the truth. I already told them. They don't want to listen. We don't pray for them.
No.
I'm just making a comment. Is we have to continue to pray when we have the Spirit of Christ.
Yes.
We will not take things personal. We will do what we have to do as Christians, which is
pray for everyone. It doesn't matter if they don't talk to me. It doesn't matter if they don't agree with what I believe, even though I know I have the truth. I will continue praying for them. Just like Abraham, it doesn't matter what happened, he still prayed for Lot.
Yes.
So our responsibility as Christian is to pray for everyone, pray for our family, pray for church members that have left the church, mm-hmm. and they know the truth and they're not coming back, but we need to pray for them continuously.
Yes, and that's what I mentioned at the very first, in the beginning, the greatest victories gained for the cause of God are not the result of labored argument. They are gained in the audience chamber with God when with earnest agonizing faith, men lay hold upon the mighty arm of power. Let us pray for one another. Let us ask God to stick close with us and help us as we go through this life. May God bless you.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Mangela. Thank you, class, for your participating, and for those online viewing, grateful to have you with us today. Another wonderful subject, another wonderful topic. We are going to close with a prayer. Here locally, we are going to be picking up a Sabbath School offering. For those watching online, we want to encourage you to go to our website, and you'll find there the link for online giving, and you can contribute to Sabbath School. Even though you're not here, you can still contribute. We appreciate that. So we'll close with the prayer, and then we're going to have our deacons pick up an offering here locally this morning. Let's pray together. Father in heaven, we thank you for this wonderful study into the life of Abraham and the covenant, Lord. We just pray that you will continue to work in our lives and that we will be faithful to you. Bless as we continue to honor you on this day. Keep us safe, we pray, in Jesus' name. Amen. Again, thank you for tuning in this morning and watching and being a part of our class. We'll see you next week at 9:45 as we continue our Sabbath School lesson.